I started painting actually when I was a teenager until like first year of college. I started painting, and then I went to this really kind of classical art school where you have to go for 4 years of drawing, 4 years of history of art, 4 years of aesthetics, of philosophy, right? And you first year, and then the second year you get to option between like photography, painting, and sculptor. But the first year they teach you everything, like basically volume as a beginner to sculptor, color theories and stuff like that. So it's very, very, you get a really good education, but in the academic, in the art school in Chile. But I start painting and I major mostly in, I focus in history of art, and then the third year I start working with video and photography, and then I never, I was too bored of how long a painting takes, so I rather to like start shooting photos and videos. But I never took a camera, I grabbed a camera before my second or third year of college. So but I've been watching like 2 or 3 movies a day since I'm like 14, so I just like the videotheque I have in my head is like, it was larger than like, you know, my capacity to make work. So I was like obsessed with movies all my life, so, and still, but I have less time to watch it, so Law and Order is a lot easier to watch. I paint and I draw a lot stills from movies.
Really? Now still or earlier?
Earlier. Mm-hmm. I did a lot of like drawings of I remember freezing the VCR and they just doing really quick drawings.
Yeah.
But then they just suddenly like the same that why I don't make narrative films is just like my attention span just like decline every year. It's just I have less and less and less. In Chile, you watch TV and it's all double, right? There is sometimes you lose sync. Everything is they have a guy that is Al Pacino's voice, for example, right? And that guy can also be some character from The Simpsons' voice, right? So like since early age, you understand that there is the image is an image, and the voice and the meaning come from somewhere else. When you like, I mean, you losing out of phase, it's just funny, you know, when somebody is just talking and the mouth keep moving, but the sentence end like 10 seconds ago. And those flaws are funny, but like, it's really like, when that is all what is being given to you, you start distrusting the information a lot more. Chilean or like Latin American culture is very much, very hierarchical, right? So like you can be involved in the adults' war.
In a what?
In the adults' war, you know,
adults
like
world,
you
yeah.
Can, you can really be part of that. So when you are a kid and they are having a conversation, and you know, it's like now in adult, like, they are not the smartest or like the most interesting people. So I don't know why they don't let you be part of those conversations. But you have to sit far away or be by the door frame, having this. Like looking at people having conversation and crying or having these interesting arguments, and you know that you are not allowed to access them, so you like start being aware of like your mom's face, and you know when she's worried, you know when other people are worried, you know that your parents fight but you don't know why, so you grow up with this mythology about like what happened inside the house that like you're not part of it because you are not allowed to understand it. The worker number one, you know, I work on that when I was in New Mexico, and I have this idea that I could build a house just by throwing pieces of wood in the air, you know, hopefully it's gonna like, something's gonna work. I mean, so I just irrational, I don't, it's like visually I could build it, you know, like doesn't need to get built, just need to exists in somebody's mind, like in somebody's eyes. So have no depth, have no, it's just meant for the photograph, this building. So I could just throw around the wood until, and then I have the choices of like customize, when I keep taking photos until I have enough floating piece of wood that I can I can adjust digitally to build something that is just meant to live in the two-dimensionality, you know? So that is what is a moment of a... that is a moment, the lack of presence that people don't appreciate in movies. It is. It's like that movies are just living in the two-dimensionality, but people are experiencing this movie in this, like, in their own time. In the, like, there is a path. They spend time with this character, so they know what is the past about, and they want to finish the movie. Basically, the movie have to end at some point, and they know the movie is going to end at some point, so it have to be a future for this character. But I'm more worried about the two-dimensionality of movies and the two-dimensionality of, like, the thought processing. How this, like, what they gain or what they lose by just existing in that realm. When you make a piece of work, or when you make a movie, and like, you want to believe that it's going farther, you want to believe that it's a... But what is not happening in two-dimensionality, you know, what is not, like, you can surrender for whatever you want, but if it's not happening in the surface, it's not happening, right? So you get to give that information, or you get to offer something that it will be seductive enough so you can engage the elements around it, you know, but there is a but not enough so, like, people cannot put it together. That happened in the city of the worker, you know. You know, all semiotic studies, like, you know, Panofsky or Levi-Strauss, when they start analyzing photographies in, like, or like photo, like art of, work of art, they could just, like, do these two different, and this is, like, all really classical history of art kind of, like, analysis. It's like you have the iconography and the iconological aspect of the work. So iconography is just, like, elements by side, by, like, identify what you see. Iconological is, like, what each element means in the context of this piece. So the experience of looking at the work have to do with, like, how many connections there is inside, and what is inside is, so it's gonna be the course of intention of the artist. You know, Levi-Strauss was, like, not like a model for me, but still, like, understanding that as a, well, I know that there is a track of thoughts like that you can, like, still value working based on just, like, what is presented inside, and all the answers are inside and not outside the work, you know. And I apply them a lot in this kind of work. With the video too, the video I have in the show, it is so fake, you know. It is like a set, and you can notice the set, and you can notice when I pop in this, like, something that looks like the ground, the whole thing bounce around, and I wanted to make it just one lighting and just me in the middle, so so you could just, like, understand that there is a setup there. There is more intentionality in the making of the thing that, like, the intentionality outside the work, you know, like the meaning outside the work come from this history of art that I like it, you know, in that case Goya's the giant or the colossal. But I really wanted to rescue the fakeness of it, like the fakeness of the experience of making the work. Because there is a beauty in the making too, you know. It's not just like a beauty in the illusion. There is, like, seeing people and appreciate that. I mean, in the most, like, mundane, like watching the making of a Steven Spielberg movie is far, far more interesting than watching the movie itself. You know, when you watch the DVD, I just go straight to the making of, and not to the movies. It's like, you know, exactly what's going to happen just with the reading the back of the CD case. But I think, like, there is something really, really beautiful knowing that, like, the things are made, you know, by somebody. So with Diamond Box, I wanted to, like, talk about my personal, and in a lot of the works I work talk about my personal history, not because I think I'm special. I just think it's just, like, it's a good source of creativity, it's just like self-examination. And then when I was living in the Central District, I could go and buy stuff at Home Depot and see these guys. And I remember I used to do the same, just sit in Home Depot and wait for work. I did it for a couple of years. So
you did it for what?
For a couple of years, like just sit outside of Home Depot and waiting for work, or like look for jobs in Craigslist. And when I just moved here, and work off Craigslist for like 4 years or something like that, just doing manual labor, landscape, everything that you can imagine. So when I had the chance, I wanted to like tell the story of these guys, but like find my story within other guys, you know, not thinking that like my story was so particular or interesting, and just thinking, bringing awareness that there is, my story is just one of thousands of thousands. And that's why I decide to divorce the voice from the image in that video. Like that's why there is not, because I didn't want that voice to belong to anybody.
La necesidad. La necesidad de...
fue algo muy rápido, porque fue incluso parte de día. Por decir, un jueves estaba hablando con él y yo tenía que salir un sábado. Entonces, fue así como...
¿Cuántos días tarda uno? Acá. Cuando uno llega a la frontera, ahí hay una especie como de hoteles, pero son casas de seguridad de los coyotes, donde reúnen a toda la gente que ellos van a pasar, que será un mínimo como de 80 personas o hasta 100 personas en un cuarto, más o menos, este espacio más o menos.
Dejé a mis padres y todo eso.
Saliendo uno ya no tiene que haber duda.
Tuvimos que arreglar todo, comprar zapatos, comida.
Crucé, yo intenté dos veces, a la segunda vez pasé, la primera vez me agarraron la migra. Y pues ahí en San Isidro, al tratar de cruzar caminando a la frontera, ahí fue donde me agarró la migra, que me iban a hacer unas preguntas, pero esas preguntas fueron como...
5 días en la cárcel, no nos daban de comer, nada, solo nos daban agua y pues no era suficiente para nosotros.
32, incluyendo a Coyote.
Nos tiraron la comida, todo lo que teníamos en la mochila nos sacaron.
You know, like a lot of the time as an artist, mostly like this rare color artist of color in Seattle, is that like people think that I can make art because I have an interesting story, or like because there's a multicultural aspect on my behavior. But I mean, being Latino here is not that weird, it's not that rare, and it's just as multicultural as coming from the middle of nowhere in a Christian town, like, and being a hippie city in Seattle, like, with like, liberal parents in Seattle. That is just even more shocking, like, more multicultural than coming from another religious country, but just be brown, you know? So it doesn't really, like, I see multiculturality and the way that you approach art, it resides in something... like in something deeper on the wheel of you actually making it, not in the way that your background it wouldn't apply. Like there is nothing that will make you an artist that is not just like a thought processing, you know, there is like the skills can lead you so far.